The history of Frisbee and Disc Golf is largely housed in the minds of those who experienced it. Sometimes, it was written down, and that's how I found most of this information. But, like most historical accounts, the events change depending on who's telling it. I've tried my best to chronicle the myths, the realities, and the growth of disc golf from its beginnings to the start of the modern era. However, I couldn't possibly highlight every single important individual or accomplishment, and, in fact, most of these people deserve their own stories. I'm just a fan doing the best I can, living other people's glory days vicariously through grainy videos, yellow magazines scanned and saved by those who cared, and my own, well, rose-tinted view of the past. And I invite you to do the same. From the beginning of humanity, people liked to throw things. Pointy sticks and rocks proved to be a valuable way for early humans to hunt animals that were much faster, stronger, and probably smarter. But the purpose of these objects changed with the growth of human civilization. Just as severed heads were gradually phased out and replaced with balls made of leather, rubber, or synthetic composites, the flying disc also changed. One example of this comes from the ancient Greeks. In the original Olympic Games in 776 BCE, discus was played alongside long jump, spear throwing, sprint racing, and wrestling. The discus was made by pouring molten bronze or iron into the sand to mold it into shape. After cooling, the edges were smoothed out and made ready for competition. The early discus was thought to possess godlike powers, and they were revered by the Greeks. Those who could throw the farthest would honor the gods, and, in return, they would be honored within society. The event was immortalized by Myron's sculpture of Discobolus, and, to a much lesser extent, Discophoros by Polycletus. However, the glory of the discus and the Olympics fell with the Greek Empire, and they wouldn't return until about the 1870s. But in that time, people still threw things in the name of sport. Trees, fists, baseballs, really anything that could be thrown was thrown. Legend has it that one day, in 1827, a Yale student named Elihu Frisbee was sick of being forced to attend the school's chapel. As Elihu sat in his pew, the collection plate was passed to him. And, overcome by his frustration, Elihu threw the collection plate out of the chapel and onto the campus grounds. Students passing by picked up the collection plate and threw it again and again, and, apparently, this is how the game of Frisbee was born. And it became a favorite pastime among students until the Great Collection Plate Shortage of 1873. Now, of course this didn't happen, but I wish it did. I think history would be much better with straightforward and simple answers. Nonetheless, I'll continue on with what most people cite as the true history of Frisbee and Disc Golf. The term Frisbee comes from the Frisbee Baking Company, which opened in Bridgeport, Connecticut in 1871, and the loading dock of that Bridgeport factory became the birthplace of Frisbeeing. Delivery drivers for the Frisbee Baking Company passed the time before their daily routes by tossing pie tins to each other and discovering how to throw them best. Once a pie tin cracked or became too crumpled to throw, they could simply grab a new one and play without concern of slicing their fingers on the sharp metal. By sheer happenstance, these delivery drivers became the first Frisbee experts. By the early 20th century, Frisbee pies and their tins were delivered to over 6,000 stores, restaurants, and colleges across the Northeast United States. And soon the game of Frisbee found its way to Harvard, Dartmouth, Yale, Amherst, and Princeton. Students playing catch with their pie tins would yell Frisbee to warn people of their bad throws, just as ball golfers yell four to signal a bad shot. At the time, it was just a catchy name. It's worth mentioning that there seems to be two camps in the Frisbee creationist mythos, the Frisbee pie tin camp and the cookie lid camp. It appears that both forms of the game appeared independently and essentially simultaneously, and both had been played for decades. Where the cookie lid game was popular, there is very little pie tin tossing, and vice versa. However, over time, the pie tin tossing game established itself because pie tins were readily available, a fresh pie cost much less than a tin of cookies, popcorn, or potato chips. Nonetheless, if something could be thrown, it was thrown. And, more often than not, people invented games to go along with it. In 1922, 11-year-old Tex Robertson of Sweetwater, Texas, made his own games with a metal cover of a 1 gallon container of shortening. Tex and his friends played forms of baseball, football, and golf, and Tex continued to play these games well throughout his childhood. In 1933, Tex had moved to Michigan and established the first flying disc games at the Wolverine Day Camp near Ann Arbor. Using the paper lids from ice cream containers, Tex taught the children his games and the basic throwing techniques. He urged the children to sail it low and level. This saying would be boiled down into "say low," and it became the name of both Tex's flying discs and the games he invented with it. In 1939, Tex and his wife Pat had moved back to Texas and founded Camp Longhorn at Inks Lake in Burnett, Texas. Soon, Tex introduced his campers to the game of say low golf by laying out 5 hoops around the campgrounds for children to toss their metal and paper say lows. And because of Tex's fascination, say low became an important part of Camp Longhorn's summer activities for decades. And during this time, kids all around the world were making their own games. In 1927, up in the small town of Bladworth, Saskatchewan, 10-year-old Ronald Franklin Gibson and a group of his friends drew circles in the dirt of the schoolyard and tried their best to get paint can lids into the circles in as few throws as possible. They called this game Tin Lid Golf. Though they enjoyed playing this game throughout the school year and well into summer vacation, they grew up and stopped playing the game in pursuit of loftier goals like romance and work. Most people cite this moment as the creative inception of disc golf. However, like most flying disc games, it was created independently for the enjoyment of a brief moment. Sometimes these creations last, most times they don't. The important part was having fun. In 1937, the Buck Rogers Flying Saucer premiered. The toy was created by fastening 2 paper plates together with a metal ring. This was a massive advancement in flying disc technology, but it was so difficult to throw that people just stuck with their tin lids and pie tins. That same year, Walter Frederick Morrison and his girlfriend Lucille had Thanksgiving dinner with Lucille's family. As they were relaxing in the backyard, her brother brought a popcorn lid out, and the three of them began to play catch. Walter, or Fred, as he liked to be called, enjoyed the game and continued playing with Lucille throughout their relationship. Soon after, Fred discovered that cake pans flew best, and he would purchase them for 5 cents. One day, while he and Lucille were playing catch on the beach, someone approached them and offered to pay 25 cents for their cake pan. They accepted and saw the potential for a business. They took that 25 cents and bought 5 more cake pans. Fred and Lucille married in 1939, and Fred sold his cake pans as a side business until he joined the U.S. Army Air Force in 1942. In his time in the military, Fred flew in 58 missions over Italy before being shot down and imprisoned for a month and a half in Germany's Stalag 13 prisoner of war camp. After the end of the war, Fred and Lucille settled in San Luis Obispo, California. One day while out on a walk, Fred saw children playing catch with a paint can lid. He remembered back to that Thanksgiving holiday nearly a decade ago, and the tendency for the metal to crack and cut the fingers of whoever was catching the disc. This inspired Fred to design the concept of an aerodynamic metal disc with a wire wrapped around the edge to improve both durability and stability. He called this design the Whirl-Away, named after the famous racehorse Whirl-Away. This was Fred's first creative step in the flying disc business, and it also began Frisbee and Disc Golf's flirtatious relationship with copyright infringement. But the Whirl-Away wouldn't be produced as Fred designed it. The plastic boom following World War II saw more and more items created with synthetic polymers. This, of course, included toys. Fred and another World War II veteran named Warren Francione formed PIPCO, the Partners in Plastic Company. With the funds provided by Francione, Fred and Warren bought a lathe, set it up in Warren's basement, and used it to carve the first flying disc out of a hard and fragile Tenite plastic. To capitalize on the UFO craze of the time, they dubbed this creation the Flying Saucer. Fred and Lucille traveled to county fairs, trade shows, and other community events to showcase the invention and demonstrate what people could do with a flying saucer and an invisible string. They showed the crowd how a flying saucer could curve, boomerang, or fly straight to the person at the end of the invisible string. Unfortunately, if the flying saucer hit the ground, it would probably shatter. Though that wasn't a big deal, the flying saucer was free, but they sold the invisible string for $1. This type of cute yet deceptive marketing ploy would not be tolerated by the FTC nowadays, but at the time, it proved to be exactly what PIPCO needed. In 1948, PIPCO expanded their production to create the first molded plastic disc. These new models were made of a softer plastic and sold similarly to the original flying saucers. But after seeing Al Capp include a UFO in his popular Little Abner comic strip, Fred and Warren saw an opportunity. In exchange for Capp using PIPCO's flying saucer toy in a Little Abner comic strip, Fred and Warren renamed their invention the Little Abner Flying Saucer, and they paid Capp a small royalty too. The Little Abner Flying Saucer looked like the hot new toy until Capp saw that PIPCO reprinted the comic strip to sell within the toy's packaging. Capp sued the company for $5,000 in damages, and PIPCO soon ceased operation. As a result, Warren Francione sold his home, reapplied for active duty in the Korean War, and quickly lost interest in the flying disc business. And though Francione had an immeasurable impact on the origin of the flying disc, his contribution to the invention's history is often overlooked. Morrison, on the other hand, moved to Los Angeles, became a building inspector, and still dreamed about flying saucers. Around that time, two University of Southern California graduates, Richard Knurr and Arthur Spud Mellon, began a business of selling slingshots out of Richard's garage in Pasadena, California. They called this company Wham-O, after the sound the slingshot made when it was fired. And as they were looking to expand their business, they began traveling to trade shows and county fairs, looking for the next big toy. Allegedly, another flying disc creation myth happened around this time. In 1949 at Amherst College in Massachusetts, a student was carrying a tray of beer across campus. The student tripped on the steps of Johnson Chapel and lost control of his tray and the beer. Though the beer crashed to the ground, the tray floated, curved, and landed softly on the sidewalk. Several students walking by were stunned to see this phenomenon and were determined to investigate this magical moment. They took the tray to the professor of physics, Aaron Frisbee. And thus, after learning about the aerodynamic qualities of the tray, the game of Frisbee was born. The students of Amherst College taught the game to Smith College and Princeton, and soon the game spread across the world. To be honest, I don't know what I believe less. The idea that several students stood in shock after witnessing the beauty of a falling drink tray, or a physics professor named Aaron Frisbee. Nonetheless, this absolutely did not happen, but now you know a useless piece of trivia. You're welcome, and I'm sorry. Back in reality, Fred Morrison founded his own company, American Trends, in 1951. His first decision was to buy the remaining stock of flying saucers from the injection molding company that PIPCO used. And soon, Fred discovered that he could produce his own flying discs at a much lower cost. And after creating his first run of flying saucers, he was able to get them sold at Disneyland. But after an errant throw at a park visitor, Disney pulled the product, and Fred was back to the drawing board. After a few years, Fred redesigned his flying saucers and created a new model, the Pluto Platter. These new discs carried the mantra, play catch, invent games, and after producing his own stock of Pluto platters, Fred once again started traveling to county fairs and trade shows to promote his Pluto platters by dressing up in a spacesuit made by Lucille. Across the country in Etna, New Hampshire, a ski instructor named Ernest C. Robes had been working on an invention of his own. He worked at the Kimball Union Academy boarding school in Meriden, New Hampshire, and saw that children would often cut their fingers by throwing and catching their pie tins. This inspired him to create his own flying disc in 1953, which he called the Space Saucer. Robes made the Space Saucer by heating Colatron plastic over his stove and shaping it over the agitator of a washing machine. Over time, Robes would improve his design and file a patent for an aerial disc in 1955. Throughout this period, Robes' students would graduate and attend colleges throughout the Northeast. This included Dartmouth. And soon, seeing the success of the Space Saucer, Robes was in negotiations with Parker Brothers. But because Parker Brothers wanted to change the design of the Space Saucer and pay Robes in royalties instead of a lump sum, Robes turned down the offer. Regardless, the Space Saucer was still soaring in the Northeast. And, as the Space Saucer was becoming the favorite disc among Frisbee players at Dartmouth, Fred Morrison was still dressed in a spacesuit and promoting his Pluto platters along the West Coast. And people didn't need Fred Morrison to tell them to invent games. They already did that themselves. During this time, the first flying disc competitions were held. On November 7, 1954, Dartmouth College hosted a rugby team from Montreal, Quebec, in a game of Frisbee. For this game, the team stood 10 meters apart and threw a 5-inch metal cookie lid between the two teams. One team would throw the lid, and the other team would try to catch it with one hand to score a point. More than 150 spectators witnessed the event that they called the International Frisbee Championship. The event was a gentleman's game, including a dress code and a code of conduct. And when someone made a particularly good catch, the team stopped playing and gathered together for a round of snaps. This consisted of all players gathering together and snapping their fingers in appreciation. Look at these wholesome kids. In the end, the Dartmouth team won by a score of 21-16. And unlike today's Guts game, where discs are thrown up to and over 100 miles an hour, players would use finesse shots to try to curve the disc around the other team. In a Los Angeles parking lot in 1955, as Fred Morrison was packing away his sweaty spacesuit, he had a chance run-in with Rich Nur and Spud Mellon of Wham-O. Wham-O was looking to expand its business with some new toys and was very interested in Fred's creation. After a few months of negotiating, Fred sold the rights to the Pluto Platter in 1956. And on January 13, 1957, Wham-O began mass producing their own flying discs. Without Fred Morrison, maybe we'd all be throwing space saucers. Maybe we'd still be throwing tin lids into circles in the dirt. What's certain is that no matter how much help he received, Fred Morrison became the father of the flying disc. And soon, the Pluto Platter would take on a life of its own. In 1958, the Frisbee Baking Company closed its doors, but by this time, their name had already become synonymous with flying discs on the East Coast, and the joy and creativity that stemmed from throwing their pie tins had grown. In Eagle Harbor, Michigan, the first international Frisbee tournament featured Guts as its main event. This was a tongue-in-cheek name given to the Healy family reunion. The Healy brothers, Bob, John, Tim, and Peter, formed a team that they called North Central, and are credited with winning the first 9 IFTs. However, there's no evidence to support that the event was anything more than a family gathering. The first real IFT was held sometime around the mid-1960s, with teams across the country making the trek to Eagle Harbor in the name of competition, and they continue doing so to this day. In 1959, Wham-O decided that the Pluto Platter needed a name change. Keeping with the space craze motif, Wham-O tried names like Speedy, Sailing Satellite, and even Sputnik. However, these names lacked the instant recognition they desired. After learning that college students out east yelled Frisbee to warn people of their errant throws, Wham-O branded their disc the Frisbee, with a new spelling to try to create a unique trademark. However, it's worth mentioning again that Frisbee was already a general term. The term appeared in newspapers, posters, and in the lexicon of Frisbee players for decades. But by filing their trademark, Wham-O claimed a unique use of the word Frisbee. And though this was not true, for some reason, the trademark was granted. But this part of the story can wait for another time. In the end, we can thank Mr. Nur and Mr. Mellon that we don't play saucer golf, or platter golf, or Sputnik golf. Yes, Frolf sounds much cooler. Thanks, Dick and Spud. As a toy company, Wham-O was on top of the world. By the early 1960s, their product line included slip and slides, super balls, hula hoops, and frisbees. And in 1964, they were looking for a new head for their research and development department. They found the right candidate in Ed Hedrick. Hedrick had an affinity for both frisbee and competition, and he wanted to see frisbee presented as a sport. His accuracy skills with a frisbee coined him the name Steady Ed. And in his new position, his first assignment was to figure out what to do with a warehouse full of unused plastic. His solution was to make a new kind of frisbee, the professional model. With the professional model, Hedrick added a racing stripe around the frisbee and ridges around the shoulder to give it a faster and more controlled flight. The professional model also carried an almost certainly unlicensed sticker of the Olympic rings. In 1967, Hedrick created the International Frisbee Association to aid in his goal of presenting frisbee as a sport. The IFA started publishing a newsletter, introduced the idea of a skills proficiency test, and helped Wham-O move more stock. With funds from Wham-O, the IFA sent prominent frisbee players across the world to promote Wham-O and present frisbee in emerging markets. Hedrick also sought out celebrity endorsements to aid in the promotion of frisbee sports, usually from TV and film stars, sometimes from astronauts. By this point, frisbee had become a leisure activity on par with pickup baseball, and it captured the public imagination the same way people used to be interested in boring things like space, gyroscopes, and hummingbirds. In 1968, Wham-O released the Masters Tournament Model Frisbee, increasing the size and the weight of the professional model for a better flight. That same year, Wham-O was approached by George Sappenfield, the Parks and Recreation Supervisor for Conejo Valley, California. While playing golf one afternoon, Sappenfield realized that the kids on his playground could play a golf-style game with frisbees. He asked Wham-O if they could help him with his plan to hold a frisbee golf contest for his recreation program. Wham-O sent Sappenfield frisbees and some hula hoops to use for targets. His campers had fun, and Sappenfield thought that the first frisbee golf tournament was a success. He convinced Steady Ed to add frisbee golf to the list of the events for the all-comers frisbee meet Wham-O planned to hold at Brookside Park in Pasadena, California the next year. By this point, the main frisbee sports were guts, freestyle, and frisbee dog events. But at Columbia High School in New Jersey, another frisbee game was born. This game took aspects of soccer, basketball, and football to create a team sport that the kids called Ultimate Frisbee because, well, it was the ultimate thing they thought people could do with a frisbee. Unlike the tin-lid golf from Bloodworth Elementary, the Columbia High School frisbee team all agreed that, after graduating, they would spread this new game to their various colleges across the Northeast. Around this time, the United States was more than a decade deep in the Vietnam War. In support of the troops, Wham-O sent 5,000 frisbees to the American soldiers deployed in Vietnam. Images of soldiers playing with frisbees would periodically appear in IFA newsletters. However, unbeknownst to Wham-O or the IFA, the United States military had been looking for a new way to increase airtime for their flares. Their plan was to attach flares to frisbees and throw them from low-flying planes to increase the airtime. However, because of the added weight, the frisbees would instantly drop to the ground. The U.S. Navy spent nearly $400,000 over 4 years, but the plan was ultimately a flop. In 1970, Steady had left Wham-O to form Hedrick Industries, a company creating specialized equipment for ecology. By this point, Hedrick's changes to the Frisbee already made the item more of a sporting good, but Frisbee hadn't yet become an accepted sport. So, had this business venture proved successful, the history of the Frisbee would look completely different. Nonetheless, the first Frisbee Club was organized around this time in Rochester, New York. Local Frisbee lovers, including Jim Palmieri, met weekly and played a variety of Frisbee games, including golf. They even made an object Frisbee golf course in the city parks, using trees, garbage cans, and lampposts as targets. The Rochester Frisbee Club became the first city club to hold an annual disc golf championships, and after learning about the size of the sport from an IFA newsletter, they decided to turn their 1974 city tournament into a national championship. They called this event the American Flying Disc Open, with the top prize being a brand new Datsun B210. And a surge of interest around the event grew, and this grabbed Ed Hedrick's attention much more than light meters, microscopes, and thermometers ever could. On November 6, 1869, Princeton and Rutgers played the first collegiate game of football. The final score was an unremarkable 6-4 win for Rutgers. And on November 6, 1972, exactly 103 years later, in essentially the exact same place, Princeton and Rutgers played the first intercollegiate game of Ultimate Frisbee. The final score was a more remarkable 29-27, and once again, Rutgers won the game. One of the players on the Rutgers team was nicknamed Stork because he towered over the competition, making it much easier for him to pass, catch, and generally score. His name was Dan Roddick. In 1974, it seemed that Frisbee was finally surpassing its status as a picnic leisure activity, with the most popular sport being freestyle. In May, Rutgers University held the first Octad Frisbee Tournament, an event hosting 8 different Frisbee competitions. And the Canadian Open Frisbee Championships were held in Toronto. And finally, after 3 years of running his own business, Steady Ed returned to Wham-O as General Manager and Vice President of Sales. The Super Frizz Frisbee team, created by John Kirkland and sidearm pioneer Victor Malafronte, toured across the country as the halftime show for the Harlem Globetrotters. They performed in 200 cities and for over 2 million people over their 6-month tour. Even President Richard Milhouse Nixon was bitten by the Frisbee bug. While giving a speech at the U.S. Naval Academy, a Frisbee was thrown on stage, and Nixon, wanting to show how hip he was, tried to throw the Frisbee back. The Frisbee flipped upside down and fell to the ground. After that, Nixon stuck to flashing peace signs, shaking his jowls, and not doing anything illegal because, after all, he was the president. In August of 1974, the highly anticipated American Flying Disc Open was played with a field of 62 players. Even though this didn't cover the cost of the new car, tournament director Jim Palmieri continued on with it anyway. And, unlike most events of the time, it introduced the first standardized Frisbee golf targets, which were just shallow wooden boxes placed on the ground. And, just like every course of the time, it was packed up by the end of the day. When the results were tallied, tournament director Jim Palmieri handed Dan Roddick the keys to the brand new Datsun on a plastic platter. And, even though Palmieri still had to make car payments, the American Flying Disc Open showed the viability of disc golf as a singular event. However, all focus quickly turned to the Rose Bowl in Pasadena, California, as the World Frisbee Championships were scheduled to test players in an array of Frisbee events, but not disc golf. Ed Hedrick organized the event, with players competing in distance, accuracy, freestyle, and a variety of other Frisbee events. After a long day in the California sun, Victor Malafronte and Joe Cahow were crowned the overall World Frisbee Champions. As a tournament and a promotional tool, the event was a success. and Ed Hedrick wanted more help in the promotion of Frisbee sports. So, he hired the American Flying Disc Open champion, Dan Roddick, to become the director of the sporting goods department for Wham-O. And, with some convincing from Dan, Jim Palmieri, and George Sappenfield, Steady Ed agreed to include Frisbee Golf in the 1975 World Championship. In 1975, the momentum from the previous year continued. The World Frisbee Championship returned to the Rose Bowl, and to attend, all people had to do was bring a Frisbee. Frisbee Golf was now an official event at the World Frisbee Championships, and saw Tom Kennedy win the first Frisbee Golf World Championship title. The sport seemed to be gaining some mainstream acceptance as the first permanent disc golf course was installed in Pasadena, California. The course was dubbed Oak Grove, and the first targets were just 4-foot-tall metal poles installed in the ground. These simple poles inspired more ideas from Steady Ed, and as this first course was a resounding success, seeing more than 5,000 people play the course in any given week. Later that year, Ed Hedrick left Wham-O, but this time, it was for good. Steady Ed tried to ride the upsurge of interest by creating the Disc Golf Association in April of 1976. This left control of Wham-O's sports promotion department to Dan Roddick. One of Roddick's first moves was to incorporate disc golf as an event in the national tour of qualifying events for the World Frisbee Championships. This introduced competitive disc golf to thousands of Frisbee players and opened up markets for Ed Hedrick's DGA to sell and install courses all over the country. And later that year, Dan Roddick hosted the third World Frisbee Championships, and for the first time, they had a paying crowd. Ed Hedrick's latest invention, the disc golf pole hole, replaced the rudimentary posts in the ground at the Oak Grove course, and they became a staple for any disc golf course to this day. The advancement in courses was matched with the new Night Flyer Frisbee. The Night Flyer became a favorite for disc golfers because its heavier weight made it much more wind and torque resistant, giving players much more accuracy and distance. And as Hedrick traveled the country, promoting disc golf and designing courses, he also spearheaded the largest development in disc golf, the Professional Disc Golf Association. The PDGA was a players' organization run by Steady Ed, where local clubs provided a feeder program of new players and the money to build new disc golf courses. Steady Ed sent out invitations to the top 100 Frisbee players in the country. The cost to join was just $10 for a lifetime membership. In 1978, the Disc Golf Association released the first codified set of rules for disc golf. By this point, Frisbee and disc golf had proliferated around the world, but an even more important event than the World Frisbee Championships was now on the radar of all disc golfers. The DGA and Wham-O announced the $50,000 disc golf tournament set for 1979. The winner would take home $10,000 in cash and $2,500 in merchandise, a $44,000 value nowadays. The $50,000 disc golf tournament was groundbreaking. First and foremost because of the money involved, and that grabbed the attention of Frisbee players in a variety of disciplines. Ed Hedrick organized the event and set 72 qualifying events to bring the world's best disc golfers to Huntington Beach, California. At the end of the day, Tom Kennedy beat John Connolly in a sudden-death playoff and won the sport's largest payout. Especially with the prize money, this event served as a promotional tool for both Wham-O and the DGA. And soon, a variety of different brands included Frisbees with their own products in hopes to increase their sales. And with the rise of other Frisbee sports, manufacturers began producing their own flying discs. In 1980, Destiny Disc Golf released their own disc, the Puppy, a disc that quickly became a go-to putter for disc golf because of its smaller diameter and its 200-gram weight. However, disc golf was growing under Hedrick's control, and, fearing for his monopoly, Steady Ed made the decision to ban all other disc golf manufacturers from competitive play. Players were dismayed by this decision, and a growing number began to challenge Ed's control of the PDGA. The unintended consequence of Ed's dismissal of the other disc golf manufacturers was that players would begin looking for ways to make their own discs more aerodynamic. In 1981, the World Frisbee Championships continued, but this would be the last time the event was held at the famous Rose Bowl. That same year, a group of players started a new disc golf organization set to be run by the players. Nonetheless, they invited Ed to be the first official member. Ed declined the invitation, lashed out at the organizers, and used his status to extinguish the newfound organization before it had time to grow. This particular incident alienated many players, and Ed's popularity suffered. And when Ed decided to hold the first Disc Golf World Championships in Los Angeles, California in 1982, he reasserted his decision that players could only throw Wham-O discs, the brand he was selling and making royalties from at the time. Until 1982, Hedrick was essentially doing everything in the PDGA by himself. Considering how active he was, running a startup company, traveling the country, promoting a new sport, and installing courses, it's amazing that he had any time at all to process new memberships, write newsletters, and keep the PDGA going. He viewed the PDGA as his organization, and his decision to only allow Wham-O Frisbees at the first PDGA World Championship stood when Harold Duval was crowned the first PDGA World Champion. But it was at the first PDGA World Championship that the seeds of the present-day PDGA Tour were sown. Ed asked if anyone wanted to help put together a pro tour for the next year. Ted Smethers volunteered and assembled a database of courses and scheduled the first PDGA Tour for 1983. This tour served as the qualifying events for the second PDGA World Championships set for Huntsville, Alabama. And as the PDGA celebrated its first World Championships, the all-around Frisbee competitions began to split off into individual groups. In 1983, Kransko, the maker of the boogie board, bought Wham-O for $12 million. This change meant the end for both the World Frisbee Championships and the International Frisbee Association. At the time, the IFA had over 100,000 members in over 30 countries. And with Wham-O's withdrawal from the promotion of Frisbee sports, the PDGA continued to grow, and other flying disc manufacturers began to blossom. Discraft released the Skystreak, and Innova Champion released their first disc, the Eagle. The Eagle was a major jump in flying disc technology. The lower profile disc had a beveled edge that aided in wind resistance, distance, and angle control. It also accentuated the flight paths of a flying disc so that shot shaping was now a real possibility. This giant leap in technology made the Eagle the go-to driver for disc golf instantly. And though the PDGA still operated under Hedrick's choice that only Wham-O Frisbees could be thrown in competition, tournament directors Tom Monroe and LeVon Wolf told Ed that any legal disc could be thrown in competition. This inclusion guided Jeff Watson and Marie Jackson Elsner to world championship titles. And it was the first time that the players beat Ed in a contest of wills. This Huntsville controversy, more than anything else, persuaded Ed to slowly relinquish his control of the PDGA. In 1984, the advancements in flying disc technology continued with Innova Champion's release of the AVR. And at the 1984 PDGA World Championships in Rochester, New York, Steady Ed handed control of the PDGA to a group of players. At the players' meeting, Ed ceremoniously handed Ted Smethers a green bottle of Genesee Cream Ale as though bestowing the keys to the disc golf kingdom. This was a pinnacle moment for the PDGA because players now began to assume leadership roles in the organization. Ted Smethers and a team of players spent nearly 2 years working on various projects, including several drafts of a constitution. During this time, Ted, Steady Ed, and the players butted heads, but slowly but surely, they made progress. In 1985, Harold Duval and Ramona Hale won the fourth PDGA World Championship. But the PDGA seemed to have its own competition in disc golf. The World Flying Disc Federation organized their first World Championships that same year, and they had a better claim to the title because it was the first time an event of that name was held outside of the United States. 134 players from 21 countries assembled in Helsingborg, Sweden to throw some frisbees. Overall, the event was a success, and it saw a considerable amount of media coverage throughout the disc sports world. At the end of the day, Sam Farrens and Tammy Pellicane were crowned WFDF World Champions. The 1986 PDGA World Championships were held in Charlotte, North Carolina, and saw Johnny Sias and Vanessa Chambers win the event. Later that year, the first formal all-member election was held for the first PDGA Board of Directors. This group began to chart a course to allow the PDGA to grow into the organization that it is today. After taking the reins from Steady Ed 2 years earlier, the PDGA had finally taken its first steps as an independent organization. With Innova Champion's release of The Rock in 1987, the monopoly that the DGA and Wham-O held on disc sports was shattered. At this point, Ed Hedrick was ready to sell the DGA, though he had some second thoughts. That year, the PDGA World Championships were held in Toronto, Ontario, seeing Greg Hosfeld and Vanessa Chambers being crowned champions. This event also saw the first time that only active PDGA members could compete at the World Championships, and it's been the only PDGA World Championships to be held outside of the United States. And while the sport had grown immensely since the days of popcorn lids and pie tins, the sport was still waiting for its first truly great player. But we wouldn't have to wait much longer.